from heaven's gate, to kiss the earth with hope and grace. Sing, who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. Who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. Your hands be lifted up, let the redeemed declare the love, and we bow down at heaven's gate to kiss the feet of hope and grace. Sing, who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. Who is this King of glory?
Welcome to Timberline Church. We are excited to be here this morning. We are stepping in place of Gary, who is out on vacation up in Canada, enjoying some beautiful weather, I'm sure. This weekend, we as a country, come together and we focus on our independence, and we celebrate those things that our nation has done. But this morning, we really need to focus on what God has done and the independence that He has provided for us. Around the world, there are Christians who don't have the freedoms that we enjoy, and yet we see and read and hear countless stories of their perseverance and their faith because they have a true and rooted knowledge of the independence and the freedom that Christ gives them in spite of what the world puts on them. And so this morning, just celebrate our independence as Christians and as believers and as people free from the chains of sin, thanks to the work that Christ did on the cross this morning. Won't you please stand with us as we continue to worship?
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, now hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty. find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave.
Times I've failed, still Your mercy remains. Should I stumble again, still I'm caught in Your grace. Everlasting, Your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, Your glory goes beyond all faith. Lord, I give You control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love You from the inside out. Above all else, my purpose remains. The art of losing myself in bringing You praise. Everlasting, Your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, Your glory goes beyond all faith. My heart and my soul, Lord, I give You control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love You from the inside out. Everlasting, Your light will shine. in my soul. Lord, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace, to love you from the inside out.
Truly, you are mighty. You call and empower us to be changed through your Holy Spirit from the inside out, and not just to put on a false front or to change our outward appearance. Lord, you change us through and through, and we just praise you and thank you for that. Now, as we remember again the work that you did for us at the foot of the cross, we come and remember and continue to worship you this morning. Amen.
seated. You know, it's good to be reminded of the finished work of the cross of Christ. And today, as we gather together as a body of believers, as a family, to remember the Lord's Supper, we want to invite any guests that are with us today that if you are claiming Christ as your Savior, trusting in His finished work on the cross alone for salvation, you're welcome to participate in communion with us this morning. If you have not made that commitment to Christ, we would ask that you just politely let the elements pass here in a few moments and just reflectively pray on the claims of Christ and the gospel and the need for forgiveness through his finished work. Parents, we would ask that you would supervise your children and make that determination yourself. You know, we're going to be taking this memorial meal together. It's something that the Lord gave us to remember. And it should remind us primarily of the selfless act of Christ's death on our behalf. The fact that we needed a Savior, that we were separated from God, and that that God is a just God, and that justice, His wrath and justice, had to be poured out on our sin. And Jesus selflessly, after living a perfect life, went to the cross on our behalf. And so this memorial today should give us pause to reflect on the selflessness of His love for us. He gave us the bread, which reminds us of His incarnate body, and that He unselfishly gave Himself on the cross to benefit others. And friends, that also serves as an example to us, that as we follow after Christ, as we remember His life this morning, that we in Christ exist to benefit others. The wine was a reminder of His blood. And the writer of Hebrews reminds us that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. And so as we hold on to the elements and recognize that it's a representation of Christ, the body and the blood, that it should have been our blood that God demanded. But again, Jesus paid that penalty for us. He created a relationship with us, a covenant, if you will. And a covenant is an agreement where the terms of one party are set before another, and the other party either accepts or rejects the offer. And so by taking communion, we remember the new covenant that was cut with His blood, that the work is finished, that we no longer have to try to work our way into God's forgiveness and grace, but that the work is done. And to remember that we can either accept that or reject that. And for those who have accepted today, that's why we have this memorial meal, to remind ourselves, that's right, I've accepted Christ's offer. I am forgiven. Thank you, Lord. So in a moment, I'm going to invite our deacons to come and pass out the elements. I'd like for you to hold on to both the bread and the cup. We'll take them together here after this song. But during this song, I'd like for you to be prayerfully reflecting on a few things. One, self-judgment. Ask the Holy Spirit to search your heart and confess any sin that He brings to mind. And remember that, yeah, even that, what He's bringing to mind today under the new covenant is paid for. So we need to examine ourselves. We need to look within. We need to remember back to Calvary. But don't stay there. We also look forward to His return and the day where sin will be ended. Amen. We also want to reflect on the mutual love. You know, you hear us say it around here all the time. Love God, love others, and serve the world together. We love God by obedience, and we love others through that obedience as well. And communion should remind us of how Christ selflessly loved us. And that frees us now to selflessly love others. Paul even wrote to the Corinthians addressing communion, says, don't think only of yourself, but think of others. This is Christian love. Putting others ahead of ourselves. You know, and too few Christians put that into practice, you know? When it comes to worship, it's easy to come on Sunday morning with the attitude of, you know, well, will I get anything out of the service today? But instead, we ought to be asking, what can I say or do to give somebody else a blessing? Communion reminds us of that. You know, it's something that I work very hard at, because this is so ingrained in our culture. But I like to say to people, have a nice day, or have a great day. But the problem with that is that, you know, in a sense, what I'm saying subliminally is, hey, make sure the world revolves around you today. But that's not the message of the cross. The message of the cross is self-denial. Wouldn't it be better when we greet one another or when we part company to say, be a blessing today? To continually remind ourselves of the message of the cross and the remembrance of communion, of the selfless act of Christ, and that I now exist to look for opportunities to bless others and to no longer live for myself. So as you hold the elements and as you listen to the worship team sing, think on these things, and then we'll take the elements together. Deacons, if you would come.
Giving you my heart and all that is within, I lay it all down for the sake of you, my King. Giving you my dreams, I'm laying down my rights, I'm giving up my pride for the promise of new life.
Paul records for us in 1 Corinthians 11 that on the night when he was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you." And in the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death, his finished work, until he comes. It's good to remember, isn't it? Well, we want to welcome all of you here to on this holiday weekend, 4th of July. I'm going to be sharing with you a message this morning that deeply impacted my walk. I want to be upfront with you that 90% of what I'm going to say today is not my stuff. But it's necessary. I think it's so effective at communicating these truths about God's grace to us that why try to improve upon it? But for that reason, if you want a copy of today's message, we will not be distributing it ourselves because a lot of it's copyrighted. So we want to honor that, but we can direct you to a link where you could get it from the original source, if you will. I also want to take this opportunity to remind you that next Sunday, we're going to dive into the book of Philippians, and we're going to go chapter and verse through that book, and make sure to bring your flak jacket. The book of Philippians is very clearly going to remind us that the Christian life is not an ice cream social. It's more like the fellowship of the ring. And as we dig into the fellowship of the gospel, we're going to learn that it is mind-altering, and that there is a huge call for sacrifice on our lives. And so we are, with great anticipation, I almost just like want to start today, but we're not. So make sure to bring your Bibles with you next week. You'll want to be taking notes in it. And I know some of you have trouble with that. It's okay. It's just ink and paper. It's okay to put notes in there. But there's going to be some key things that we're going to draw out of that that we'll want to hang on to. The message this morning is, the title is True-Faced. And the pastor is John Lynch. And let me just dive right in, shall you? Shall we? We all know the story. Right? Adam and Eve take the fruit. And they buy the lie, and everything changes. And the next morning in the garden, they're walking, and they hear the sound of the Lord walking in the garden, and they hide themselves. And God calls out and says, "Adam, where are you?" And Adam says, "I heard the sound of thee in the garden, and And here it is, friends. And I was afraid, so I hid myself. I got afraid because for the very first time, I knew that I had done wrong, and I realized that I was naked. And so I hid myself. I covered myself. And on that day, Adam initiates a horrible legacy. It's the first time that we see a man looking over his shoulder and seeing his eyes dart. And to begin to cover himself and to pretend to be something that he is not. And so sin enters the world. And the effects of that ripple out all the way to you and to me. And so now when I get afraid, or when you get afraid, when we get embarrassed or exposed, when we do something or when something is done to us that convinces us, I'm not enough. I knew it. I'm not enough. I don't match up. I get afraid. And I hide myself. And I put on a mask. And I do the dance. And we perform for acceptance. It goes something like this. You know, if I'm good enough, talented, diligent, beautiful, together enough, right, correct enough, I will be loved and accepted and happy. That's how it goes. And if not, I'll be rejected and receive a lousy life. Pastor John Lynch calls it the Santa Claus is coming to town theology. You see, we created Santa Claus because we couldn't handle God. Truth is, we can't handle Santa Claus. I mean, yeah, we made him all jolly and chubby and sassy, but the truth is, this guy's a controlling legalist with almost unlimited power. Oh, you better not shout. You better not cry. You better not pout. I'm telling you why. Let me tell you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. He's making a list. For crying out loud. Oh yeah, he's checking it twice. He's writing it down for future reference. He's going to find you out. He's going to find out who's been naughty or nice. He knows when you've been sleeping, which in my book is wrong. When I'm asleep, I don't want anybody in my room. Stay out of my room. But there it goes. It's all over our billboards. It's everywhere we look. Our value is on how much stuff you do right and how little you do wrong. And he's going to find you out. He's watching. So you better watch out. You better fear this guy. You better stop your crying and sniveling. You better not pout. You better put on a good face and pretend like you're somebody different than you actually are. No matter how you feel, you better put on a good show. So doggone it, just be better than you are for goodness sake. Don't be a whiner. Fix yourself. Try harder. Do more. Be better. Don't have so many problems. Watch over your shoulder. Keep up appearances. Get better in a hurry. And if you can't, act like you are because you're constantly on trial. If you want good things to happen in your life, then you better figure out how to keep this guy happy. Guys, it's genetically wired into us from the fall. From the fall, we learn early on to perform because we're told early on that the highest value is on being accepted. And the means of that acceptance on this planet appears to be performance. And performance is hard because, doggone it, I fail. It's another result of the fall. The assumption that no one else fails quite like me. I assume that you have it all together and that I'm failing in a unique way. And I live with this secret awareness, if you could get inside of my heart, of just how poorly I'm doing at any given moment. I know I'm unfit, I'm unworthy, and to some degree unlovable. And so it makes me feel naked. So on comes the mask. On comes the dance. On comes some sort of covering that says, I'm enough. I'm enough to be loved by you. I'm enough to be accepted. Look, I can do this, and this could happen, and I can do this. I know that chameleon's dance really well. So nobody must know. I must mask myself with enough reason to be loved. I must brag. I must put others down. I must pretend that I am more than I am. I must idealize myself. I must posture. I must mask. And then comes the gospel. Ah, that sweet, liberating breath of fresh air, the gospel of Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:21. He, God, made him, Jesus, to be sin on our behalf, that I might have the righteousness of God. You hear that? That I, Steve Hudson, this scoundrel, might have the righteousness of God. Go figure. That on my worst day, I am robed in righteousness. Because of Jesus is willing to become naked and stay naked and not hide himself and pay the penalty for my sin. And so we actually begin to start to believe at that point that I'm lovable because he loves me. And new wiring fills my circuits. We're delighted in. We're holy. We're righteous. And we begin believing that he created us lovable. And that I'm exactly who he wanted me to be. I mean, if you read Psalm 139, you can't escape that. You see, I think that a lot of us think that he really just doesn't like us, and we screwed things up by praying the prayer. I mean, he doesn't like us, but someone hands us the prayer, and we start praying it, and God's going, oh, no, no, angels, stop that one. I don't like him. I've never liked him. Please, oh, he prayed the prayer. Okay, you're in. But I don't like you. Never liked you. Stay out of my way. A lot of us act like that's how God is. But that's not. No. That's not it. The truth is, he made us exactly who he wanted us to be. Go figure. He only had to break through the chasm of sin separation, and this radically remakes us. And so everything that I'm going to share from this point forward is dealing with someone who has accepted Christ's finished work on the cross. It is true of believers. And so we accept this gospel, and it remakes us. And then we're going along, and we're doing just fine, unless something happens. Now, you tell me. Maybe you go through a season where you don't experience his love as much, or you feel dry in worship. I mean, you raise your hands, but your mind is totally somewhere else. Maybe you failed God pretty badly. I mean, really badly. Something that you thought you would never do again. You promised, God, I'm never doing that again. And then you did it over and over. And then suddenly, gradually, the lie reawakens. And you start to think that maybe his absence or your bad circumstances are due to his displeasure with you. And so you start to shore things up so that you can make the grade, pass the standards, get serious about being better. You'll get things right. You'll clean house, and the river will flow again. He'll be happy again. Good things will start happening again. It'll be fine. And you guys, not long after that, you come to a fork in the road. And every believer reaches this point. You're heading along on this path. Things are going fine. And then it diverges into two paths. And you find yourself going, I want the path I'm on. I don't want to have to choose. And there's this huge pole with two signs on it. And the one sign is pointing down this path off this direction. And it says, trusting God. And over here on the other side of the pole is another sign pointing down this path, and it says, pleasing God. And you don't want to have to choose between the two, but you have to. And the reason that we have to choose is because from this point forward, it's going to represent the primary motive of our heart. And so we look at this road over here. Trusting God. Okay? Not much there. Stay in touch. Pleasing God. Yeah. This is the one. This is what I need. This is what's been missing. This is focus. I want to please him. After all he's done for me, that's the least I can do is to please him. So I choose this path. And I begin to head down that road. And I come up to this building, huge building. And as I approach it, I see that on the side of the building is a sign that says, striving to be all God wants me to be. Yeah, that's it. Striving to be all God wants me to be. It sounds like the army. Be all that you can be. This is it. This is what I needed. This focus. Oh, I bet there's people in that building just living the life, on fire for God, just like I am. And as I approach on the doorknob to enter the building, are written these words, self-effort. And I'm thinking, well, yeah, of course, that makes sense. I got to do my part. God helps those who help themselves kind of thing. And I enter the room. Loud room, huge room, much bigger than this room, full of people. And there's a hostess that comes up to me right away. She says to me in an overly kind, almost slick kind of a way, "Welcome to the room of good intentions." And I say, "Well, hey, woo, I'm so excited to be here. I am so fired up. How's everybody doing?" And the room gets real quiet. And a representative kind of steps out of the crowd and says, "We're doing fine. Pretty fine. Fine as fine can be. That's us. I've got some investment, things doing on a release assignment. I'm kind of good on a continuum basis. We're liquid. Fine. Bill, Marcia, Bob, Tim, we're fine, aren't we? We're all fine. Fine. Fine as fine can be. That's us, aren't we? Yep, that's us. We're fine. Okay, great. I'm glad we got that settled. You're fine." And the hostess says, "And how are you?" And I go, "Well, I'm struggling with a few things. I'm battling with." And she does this. And she hands me a mask. And it looks not unlike what everybody else in that room is wearing. And I don't want to put the mask on, but I look around the room and everyone's doing this. And so I put the mask on. And I find myself saying, "Well, I'm doing fine. Sort of fine. Thank you for asking." I'm in the room of good intentions. And as I walk through the room, I see a banner on the back wall that says, "Working on my sin to achieve an intimate relationship with God." Yes! Oh, that's it. Working on my sin. I know I've seen it this way. Somewhere I've seen this. God's like way over there, and out here in between is all my sin. And I'm over here. And so, I gotta get this cleaned up. So working on my sin to achieve an intimate relationship with God. Yeah, And he's so far away. I just want to be close. I want to have that intimacy with him. I want to be close to you. I'll get this cleaned up, God. I'll get to work right away. I'll fix it. You'll see. It'll be better. And nobody tells me that every day there's 25 more truckloads of this stuff getting delivered. But this room, you guys, it's got everything. It's got sincerity, perseverance, courage, diligence, full-hearted fervency, and a desire to please God. Sold-out determination, pursuit of excellence. Oh, this is the place I've been looking for. I'm going to make him so happy. One day soon, I know that we're going to be so close. But as weeks turn into months, we begin to notice that a lot of people in this room sound sort of cynical. And they look pretty tired because they're working so hard. And they're bluffing. And many of them seem very alone. And if you look carefully, if you catch them at just the right moment when they think no one's looking, you can see that they're in an incredible amount of pain. Conversations seem superficial and guarded. And you know, I'm starting to think differently now that I've been in this room for a while. I'm no longer relaxed here. And I have this nagging anxiety that if I don't behave well, if I don't control my sin enough, I'm going to be on the outs with everybody in this room and maybe with God. And so I start investing more effort into sinning less, and actually, I start to feel better for a while. But the more time I spend in the room of good intentions, the more disappointment I feel. And despite all my striving, all my efforts, doggone it, I keep sinning. The same sin over and over again. Some days I'm fixated on trying not to sin. I can't seem to do enough. I never get through my list. It feels like if I'm making every effort to please a God who's never pleased enough. And I soon realize that this pleasing God road has turned into what must I do to keep God pleased. And I'm tired. And I'm limping. And I'm bluffing, and my mask hurts. You see, when we embrace this path, we reduce godliness to this formula: more right behavior plus less wrong behavior equals godliness. More right behavior plus less wrong behavior equals godly man. And there's only one problem with that, other than the fact that it's biblical heresy. And that is that it disregards the godliness and righteousness that God has already placed in us at the moment we embraced Christ's finished work. Yes, we mature in godliness, but when we disregard the godliness and righteousness and holiness that is already ours from trust, we do something horrible. We put ourselves in a performance mode, and we put on the mask, and we live in hiddenness. You guys, listen. Listen very carefully. You cannot resolve your sin by working and working and working on it. It's a little bit like rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic. You may change the behaviors for a while, but when we strive to sin less, we don't sin less. And the formula creates a permission system for a dozen disguises, and it causes us to lose hope, and it keeps us immature. And this theology is breaking our hearts. And even though this toxic thinking has let us down 1,000 times, we keep trying to control our bad habits and our sin. And so here we are, exhausted. And God, I just want to be so close to you. I'm doing everything that I can. But this Jesus that I came for, I don't even know who I am anymore. And I can't keep playing this game. And I walk out. Maybe for weeks. Maybe for months, maybe for years. But eventually I come back to that fork in the road again. And so here I am. And I see it again. Trusting God. Is there another path, please? But there isn't. And so out of lack of options, I head down that road. sounds so much less heroic. It seems like there's nothing for me to do except trust. I'm used to hearing that in order to get holy, you got to sell out, care more, get on fire, buck up, shape up, commit more, feel some sort of shame that will jumpstart better behavior. So limping, I walk down this road, and I see another huge building. And as I approach, I see on the side of the building a sign that says, it says this, living out of who God says I am. Whatever. Living out of who God says I am. What does that mean? And as I approach, written across the doorknob is this word, humility. I never could do this, and I can't do it now. God, if I'm going to do this, you have to do this, God. You have to help me. And I enter the room, another loud room. And a hostess comes up to me and says, welcome to the room of grace. How are you? Well, I've been here before. So I say, doing fine, pretty fine. Who wants to know? And the room stays quiet. And so now I'm mad because I feel judged. And so finally, I've had enough, and I call out, all right, listen, I'm doing not fine. I haven't been fine in a long time. I'm tired, I'm confused, I'm afraid, I'm guilty and lonely. I'm sad most of the time. I can't make my life work. I'm so far behind and befuddled on what to do next, it mostly leaves me frozen. And if any of you knew half of my daily thoughts, you wouldn't want me in your little club here. And so there, I'm doing not fine. Thank you for asking. And I turn to leave, when from way in the back of the room, I hear this voice. That's it? That's all you got? I'll take your confusion and guilt and bad thoughts. I'll raise you compulsive sin and chronic lower back pain. Oh, yeah, and I'm up into debt up to my ears, and I wouldn't know a classical music from a show tune if it jumped up and bit me. You better come up with a more impressive list than that if you want to compete with me, buddy. And the hostess nudges me and says, I think he means you're welcome here. Well, now I'm kind of emboldened, and I walk up, as he's approaching me, and I walk up and say, hey, do you have trouble remembering people's names and birthdays? And he's like, I can't even remember my own some days. And he puts my arm around me and ushers me into this warm room of grace. And there isn't a mask to be seen anywhere. In this room, is this room just some kind of ethereal game that we're making up here? Is this all pretend and smoke and mirrors? I mean, come on, Pastor, you got to be kidding me. John Lynch writes a piece in his book by the same title, True Faced, that's called God's New Testament Gamble. And he wrote it because he says that he's doing this as a parent now. And if he teaches these truths, the question that he's asking is, will his children play Christianity life? Will they take advantage of God? Or will it grow them up to be mature God lovers? Does this work? I mean, the Judaizers in Paul's day hated this message. I mean, Paul in Romans chapters 5 through 8 is addressing that very issue, and they're saying, you dare tell people this? You dare tell people who they are in Christ? You dare tell them that the list is over? Paul, if you do that, they're going to space out. To what? They're going to do Christianity light. They're going to take advantage of God. They're not going to care as much. They're not going to live for Jesus, Paul, if you tell them that. And Paul says, you know, you've got a point. That would be exactly right, except for two things. One, they have a new identity. And not only that, they have the Holy Spirit constantly. Paul says to the Judaizers, they don't want to take advantage of God anymore. And by the way, if they wanted to, they could take advantage of God under grace or law. But what if the goal is to free their hearts so that they could come and be intimate and close to this one that they've fallen in love with? Well, that would take grace. And that's the gamble. It's God saying this. What if I tell them that there are no lists? What if I tell them who they are? What if I take away any element of fear or condemnation, judgment, or rejection? What if I tell them I love them and will always love them? That I love them right now, no matter what they've done, as much as I love my only son. That there's nothing they can do to make me love them less or love them more, or to make my love go away. What if I tell them that I don't keep a log of past offenses, of how little they pray or don't, how often they let me down, promises they've made that they don't keep? What if I tell them that they're righteous with my righteousness right now? What if I tell them they can stop beating themselves up, that they can stop being so formal, stiff, and jumpy around me? What if I tell them that I'm crazy about them? What if I tell them, even if they run to the ends of the earth and do the most horrible, unthinkable things, that they, when they come back, I would receive them with tears and a party? What if I told them that? What if I told them that if I'm their Savior, they're going to heaven no matter what, it's a done deal? What if I tell them that they have a new nature, saints, not saved sinners who should now buck up and do better if they were any kind of Christian after all he's done? What if I tell them that I actually live in them now, that I put my love, power, and nature inside of them at their disposal? What if I tell them that they don't have to put on a mask, that it's okay to be who they are at this moment with all their junk, that they don't need to pretend about how close we are, how much we pray, how much Bible we read? What if they knew that they don't have to look over their shoulder for fear that if things get too good, the other shoe's going to drop? What if they knew that I will never, ever use the word punish in relation to them? What if they knew that when they mess up, I will never get back at them? What if they were convinced that bad circumstances aren't my way of evening the score for taking advantage of me? What if they knew that the basis of our friendship is not how little they sin, but how much they let me love them? What if I tell them it isn't about their self-effort, but about allowing me to live my life through them? What if I told them that? What would happen? And this is being lived out right now in you and in me, if you're in Christ Jesus. And you guys, it's a sweet responsibility that we have. Would it work? Will we play Christianity light? Will I take advantage of it? Or will this new nature in me long for the very thing I've wanted all my life? That deep, sweet, powerful intimacy. See, Hebrews 11, chapter 11, verse 6, teaches these two paths. It says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. And the word faith in the Greek is the noun form of the word for trust. Without trust, it is impossible to please God. Do you hear both paths in that? So when I'm over here on this path trying so hard to please God, and I'm saying, I'm going to please, God says, you can never do enough to please me, and you will never learn to trust me. But when I'm over here on this trust path, God says, you know, Steve, I love you so much, kid. You please me so much. Now, you guys, pleasing God, don't let anybody lie to you. It is an incredibly good longing. But it cannot be the primary motivation of our hearts. For if all we bring to God is our moral striving to please him by solving our sin, we are way back at square one in need of a Savior again. And we're stuck with our talents, our skill, our desire, our ability, our chutzpah, our diligence, our resolve to make it happen. And we don't have it. Pleasing is not a means to our godliness. It's the fruit of our godliness. Because it's the fruit of trust. And so now I'm in the room of grace. And there's a banner on the back wall that says, standing with my God, with my sin in front of me now, working on it together. Wow. You see that picture that I had of God's way over there and the sin is separating us. Before becoming a Christian, true. As a Christian, false. The shed blood of Jesus Christ is that powerful. And now God can stand right next to me, put his hands on my shoulders, look into my eyes and say, I know all about it. I know everything. And I'm not ashamed. I love you. And together, if you'll let me, we're going to work on it. And then he would turn me and we'd face my sin. And he'd put his arm around me. And he'd probably say something like, man, you've been busy. But I got your back. All of that. Look at it. Look at it. Look at it. It's paid for. And if you'll trust me, I'm going to give you some new habits to do life different. And that'll bring me great glory. And we're going to do that together. That's life in the room of grace. Have we been changed? Yes, completely. As day is from night, we've been changed. We've received a brand new core identity. We've already been changed. And now we get to mature into what is already true about us. This is so cool. If we were to take a caterpillar and give it to a scientist and ask him to test it and to tell us, to test its DNA and tell us what is this creature, he would come back to us and he would say, we've run every possible DNA test that we know, and this creature is fully and completely a butterfly. God has put into a creature that looks nothing like a butterfly a complete butterfly identity. And because in its very nature it is a butterfly, it will mature and eventually manifest what is already true about it. And so it is with us. When we accept Christ, we have a brand new core identity, a new DNA, his godliness, his righteousness, and with his help, we will mature into what is already true about us. So God knows that on my worst day, I am Christ in Steve Hudson. That I wear a robe of righteousness all the time. And now he is just saying, Steve, for your health and for your growth and for your maturity, will you join me in believing what I already know to be true about you? It's what Peterson says in the Message. When he says in Galatians chapter 3, 2 through 6. Let me put this question to you. How did your new life begin? Was it by working your heads off to please God? Or was it by responding to God's message to you? Are you going to continue this craziness? For only crazy people would think that they could complete their own efforts that was begun by God. If you weren't smart enough or strong enough to begin it, how do you suppose that you could perfect it? Did you go through this whole painful learning process for nothing? Is it not yet a total loss? But certainly it will be if you keep this up. Answer this question. Does God, who lavishly provides you with his own presence, his Holy Spirit, working things in your lives you could never do for yourselves, does he do these things because of your strenuous moral striving? Or because you trust him to do them in you? And I know what some of you are thinking. Where was all of this decades ago before I became proficient in mask wearing? Because the problem with masks is we put them on to be loved. But the problem is the mask receives the love and we never do. And it keeps us from being loved. And so I'm beaten down now, Pastor. I've been doing this too long. It's too late for me. Well, friends, that's why Jesus Christ is building his church. It's a room of grace to teach the truths of the Word of God so that we will begin to live out of who God says we are, not just for our own healing, but to mature to the point where we invite others into the journey and see their imprisoned hearts be set free as well. And together, as we go on this journey, he begins to give us gifts. He begins to heal my unresolved sin, and to do that, he gives me repentance, formed of trust, not willpower. He gives us forgiveness, formed of trust, not begrudging compliance. And he gives us love. Learn to be received, not just given. Gifts of grace. Well, finally, you guys, not everybody stays in the room of grace, I'm sad to say, once they enter. For not only do you need to learn that you, and to learn and to believe that you are accepted, but you must learn to accept the yokels that are already there and the yokels who come in fresh each week. And they are goofy and flawed and failed and common and odd and broken and weird and sometimes unpresentable and inappropriate. Oh, sure, every once in a while a presentable one sneaks in here. But they will soon learn that their presentableness is a mask. And they too must learn to rest in the sufficiency of Jesus. Or they will go back to where appearances make the man. And so when you, fragile, broken one, when you who think you do not match up and you should not be able to stay in this room of grace, when you find yourself thinking that and you go to leave, this sweet room has a responsibility and a privilege. They will grab you. And each in their own way, they'll say, "That's it? That's all you got?" And what they'll be trying to say to you is, you really are welcome here. Stick around and receive the grace gifts and let God transform you. It's not a game. This is life in a real place. Life in the room of grace. Let me pray for us. Living God, so many of us are so tired. We've been bluffing for so long. We've been holding on, and we're tired, and we're limping, and we're scared because we don't know any other way of living. But God, we ran to this Jesus at the start of this journey. We ran to him. That's all we wanted. We didn't want anything else. We didn't know anything else. And now we come to you, Father, and we say, help me open that door with the doorknob of humility that says, God, if it's going to happen, you're going to have to do it. Take care of me, Lord. I give my life to you. I trust you. And I trust who you say that I am. And I know that right now, your arm is around me, and you're not ashamed. You've adored me before the foundations of the world, and I give you my life again. In Jesus' name, amen.
and stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then what could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against?
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Amen. As we head out today, just a couple quick reminders for you. One, coming up here, and you can have a seat. The announcements aren't that long, but it just feels weird. Gary normally does this, and I'm like, it feels weird. Okay. Walk Through the Timbers. If you are new with Timberline, coming up on July 24th at 11:45, we'll have an hour and a half lunch. And on your program, there's a little tear-off sheet. You can put your name on there and put that in the joy box on your way out today. That lets us make sure we have the right amount of food. Three things you can count on at Walk Through the Timbers. One, you'll learn how Timberline is structured and find out about our mission, vision, and values. You get a chance to meet some of the leadership and get to know them a little bit better than just a talking head. And you also meet some new friends there. And so those are the three things you can count on and a chance to evaluate. We'll just cut to the chase. This is who we are and see if this is where God's calling you to be. So we would invite you to join us. Second thing, Faith in Action Sunday is coming up at the end of this month. Fifth Sundays, we lock the doors here. And our worship service is out serving people in the community. The sign-ups are in the foyer today. There's lots of places you can do that. Or in your program, different colors. Some are pink, some are yellow, some are white. You can fill these out and place them in the joy box and sign up by using this as well if that works easier for you. But some of the projects that we're going to be doing, oil changes, we're going to continue to do that again. We average about 50 oil changes every Sunday that we do that. And so there's opportunities for changing, but we have administration, hospitality for the Life Center. We'll be providing food for the people that come as well. Dallas Center, where one day we hope to be planting a church. They'll be doing some outreach projects in that community, beginning to build Christ's reputation there and taking the gospel to that community. Rebuilding together. Guys, if you are handy with your hands, we're going to find two homes and do some home repairs for some widows that don't have the financial means to take care of that, so you can sign up or ask questions for that. We're going to work with the Urbandale Food Pantry again. We'll be downtown for the oil change folks. We'll be doing breakfast and lunch so you can cook. I mean, there's a way for someone to serve. Homeless ministries will be going out to the tent communities again. Walden Point Home will be doing a worship service there at our church plant. Also at the Woodlands Creek. Thank you. Woodlands Creek. And there's a new thing, Kids Save Garage Sale. Kids Save is a program that works with helping older orphans around the world find adoptive homes. Tonight at 10 o'clock, members of this church, we go pick up six orphans from Columbia. And with God's help, we're going to find adoptive families for these six young ladies. But we're looking to next year. It's not cheap to bring these gals up here, or guys. And so we're starting the process to raise funds for next year. So we're going to have a Kids Save garage sale. We raised $2,500 last time. So there's information on the sign-up sheet on where this is opportunity to get all the clutter out of your house. Because you can donate at the garage sale, and it'll help orphans find homes. So information and contact, if you have questions, look at that on the sign-up board. But we'll be needing help organizing that. Make a note of that. Finally, five-minute principle, which just means you're not allowed to talk to your friends for the first 5 minutes after I stop talking, okay? Remember that? And the joy box. We don't pass an offering plate here, but we would invite you to partner with us. And so if God's laying on your heart to help finance this ministry, God loves a joyful giver, not out of compulsion. And so the joy box is on your way out. You can place your tithes and offerings there so we can continue to take the good news of Jesus to this community. Be a blessing this week. Amen? Amen. Amen.
To unveil the word that would change the course of all.